It's getting increasingly more expensive to get to new wells. People have been looking at other ways to go about it. They tried something called combinatorial chemistry, and they used robots to make thousands and thousands of compounds. It was thought that this was the way to go. And so when I was on the NIH council, we were talking about this, so I asked the person in charge of chemical biology at NIH, who was giving a talk, and just how many compounds nowadays are that we could possibly make based on carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and some nitrogen. He said, somebody has actually figured this out. It's 10 to the power 62. It's a rather large number. And I said, so how many compounds can you make a year? He said, about 10 to the 6. And I said, okay, well, it's going to take 10 to the 54 years, which is a very long time. And the universe will be gone. But by that point, we won't exist, nothing will exist. So it's not a really good approach. So people are wanting to now go back and see if we could use that previous procedure. But we take things that are more familiar, that are working, and maybe we can improve the ones that we have. And so the guy who was talking, Steve Austin, is now the head of NCATS, which is the new institute at NIH. It's the National Center for Advancement in Translational Sciences. And he used a football analogy. He said, you know, we used to get the ball on the 5-yard line, and it was really hard to get down the field from the 5-yard line. And he said, but now with all these robots, you know, we can move things forward. And I said, yeah, but you know, it's still not getting there fast enough. You have to think another way. And so I'll get that. This is happening. So it's been a failure. So I told you. So I said, this is the slide I sent him. I said, I'm from down in Alabama. One thing we're really good at in Alabama is playing football. And you know, we don't care about playing West Coast offenses. Well, we don't kick the ball away unless we have to. And even when we kick it away, we can look upon that as a tactical move, not by our offense, but by our defense. So at Alabama, we were quite happy to get the ball very close to the end zone. I was down to watch the Chattanooga game. I'm big at that family game before. My son, who's a coach there, he's doing a PhD in sports pedagogy. And so he obviously ticked this, so I saw the game. So Bama scored two touchdowns in the first half. The first one was a 50 or 60 yard throw, beautiful play. And the second one was came from a punt, which the other team didn't field correctly, and we got the ball on the 5-yard line and went in and scored from there. So in drug discovery, we could use that type of approach of finding out what is working, looking at nature, looking at drugs that we've already used, and seeing if we can repurpose them or use them as the basis for a development of a new set of drugs. Because we know these compounds, to begin with, have low toxicity, because we define what their toxicity is. Any one of those other 10 to the power 62 drugs, we have absolutely no idea, even if they were effective on the target, whether they would in fact kill somebody because they did something else that was very toxic. So there are different approaches that one can use. So I'm going to say back, I'm going to move now to the second slide. That was just a few slides that were left from the first call. So we're going to talk about efficacy, we're going to talk about potency, we're going to talk about how drugs are learning things, the concepts of pathway. And you're going to get more of this, I hope, in the course, but this is just to introduce you to them. And this is, I mentioned before that there was we not only have to look at these compounds as having pharmacological action, we also have to worry about toxicology. We've also now introduced, and I'm not going to talk very much about this at all, the concept of the microbiome. This has come about in the last 5 to 10 years. We now realize that what's going on, the organisms in your gut, that exceed the number of organisms that are you by a factor of 10. So there's many, many more bugs in you than it's really you. But these are important because these can be metabolizers of the drugs, and they could also be secreting factors that go into the body that make us what we are. And so when you put a drug into the system, you may perturb all of these microbes and therefore have unexpected effects on the system. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about how we administer the drug. Drugs can be inhaled. They can be given by injecting them into the blood. You can give them intraperitoneally, which is to inject them into the peritoneal space. They can be intramuscular, intrathecal, and of course we can also apply them on the skin in form of lotions. And they can be given orally, and in some cases they can be given rectally. We need to understand something we call ADME, which is absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. So we worry about the mechanism by which a drug is absorbed. We worry about how it gets metabolized and how to control that. And we worry about how it's distributed. Does it go just into the blood or does it penetrate into the tissues? And then finally, we worry about how it's excreted, because we don't want drugs to remain in the blood forever. We also worry about the effects of pH. So pH can change the ionization state of the drug, and therefore its ability to go through a membrane may be affected by the pH of its ion at that time. And we're going to talk about potency, efficacy, and pharmacokinetics, and a little bit about designing a drug. If we have time, we'll talk about omics and personalized medicine. Hopefully I can get to that. It'll be a bit of a stretch. Okay, so this is, you're going to see this picture later, but this is the engineer's version of the gastrointestinal tract. So you take, this is the mouth, which you reach your food as a chopper, comes down the tube into the intestine, which is the area where the HCL is, that you secrete. And then it moves out into the duodenum, and we pump in some detergent and some enzymes to degrade the food. But this is where the drug is coming through. So a lot of the absorption is going to occur either through the stomach wall or through the small intestinal wall. And sometimes we actually make the drug not get absorbed here, but wait until it gets into the large bowel. There are some ways to do that. So the GI tract is an obstacle to overcome, and that's something we will talk about. Okay, so for compounds coming down the oral route, they have to be acid stable. If they're not acid stable, we can actually put them in a capsule. So you may have taken drugs before that are actually encapsulated. And so the capsule is made of gelatin. And so the enzymes that are secreted by the pancreas will digest the gelatin away, and then it releases the drug into the small intestine. So that can be done to avoid the acidity of the stomach. We talked about penicillin before, so it's given IM. And so most oral drugs are going to have to go through the gut wall in order to get into the bloodstream. And as we've said several times, the gut wall is there to stop foreign compounds. We've actually, as part of our evolution, we've largely become people who are very good at getting rid of foreign substances that we might have eaten. In pharmacology, there is a concept called the Lipinski rule. It wasn't around when I got training, because this was introduced when people had done enough studies on different drugs, it became clear that there was some rules that you could use that would predict the behavior of a drug. before you actually used it and tested it. And so it turns out that if you have more than 5 hydrogen bond donors, so these are compounds that have nitrogen and oxygen atoms with a hydrogen on, that can donate, that would prevent uptake. If it has less than 10 hydrogen bond acceptors, then it's a good drug. It has to have a molecular weight below 500 daltons, so you make a really big drug. It's probably not going to get absorbed through the GI system. And it also has got to be quite hydrophobic. So if you were to partition it between octanol, which is made carbon alcohol, and water, if the drug doesn't go largely into the octanol phase, then it's got very little chance of getting into the body. So what pharmacologists do is to take a compound that we know has high activity, and we attach a group to it that makes it more hydrophobic. And that way we can deliver it better into the body because we change its hydrophobicity. Now we hope that the modification we put on it does not take away its activity. Or if the modification we put on it can actually be removed by the enzyme systems that are present in the body. We call those compounds prodrugs because it's not that the compound has been released into its bioactive form as part of the process of being absorbed. So we're taking advantage of the metabolism to get it into the system. So you can see that each one of these necessities contain 5 or multiples of 5. So that's the rule of 5. And so these are the different ways in which things can be absorbed. They can go through specific membrane transporters. Not a lot of these are drugs, there are a few. You also have to worry about this efflux transporter. So there is a compound that's pumping whatever gets absorbed into the cell, then just pushes it back out again. There is a very small space between cells, so there are tight junctions that keep the cells together, but there are some things that can move through that space between cells. And then if the drugs that are going in by hydrophobicity, they will pass directly through the membrane and enter the cell, and then of course they're going to pass out the other side of the cell, on the basal lateral side, and when they do that, then they're going to go into the blood and go towards the liver and then onto the heart, and hence will be distributed around the body. But in these cells there are also enzymes, we call them phase 1 and phase 2 enzymes. There's a lot of these in the liver, but in fact it's quite majority, I would say 60-70% of the enzymes that are in the liver, which are metabolizing drugs, are also present in these cells, the enterocytes, that line the small intestine. And so this is the first pass prevention of the effect of the drug because of metabolism. And this is just another picture that I found that looks at these different ways. So the drugs in this case are coming in the other direction. So they're coming from the lumen. So this is the gastrointestinal lumen. And this is the interstitial, and then of course the LED would be the blood. So some are coming between the cells, some are coming through the cells and out. Some are coming through transporters of various kinds. And then there are even some that get captured into the back walls and then get pulled into the cell, and then the back wall is extracted. So you can actually absorb some larger materials via the back wall. So what governs transport? There are specific mechanisms for transport, so-called facilitated. In a facilitated transport, at equilibrium, what's inside the cell is going to be the same in concentration of what's in the lumen, but the facilitator will make that process equilibrate very rapidly. And then there are also active transporters that actually build up a concentration in the cell that exceeds that in the lumen. So these are very efficient extractors. So examples are sodium-dependent glucose transporter, amino acid transporters, and also there's a bile acid transporter that we put up there. And then there are this P-glycoprotein, proteins, the drug resistance protein, that's pumping in the opposite direction. There is passive diffusion, and so that is going to be driven by concentration, and it will try to equilibrate the concentration between the outside and the lumen and what's inside the cell. And as we noted before, the membrane behaves as if it's optimal. And then there are some paracellular events. This is a good example of a disease where you've got massive malabsorption as cholera, and so it's the failure to reabsorb water. When we do GI drugs, we'll get to know that the water is being recycled around the body tremendously. So you excrete a lot of fluids. You drink fluids, but you also excrete fluids into the small intestine, and you want these to be well recovered. If you don't, you dehydrate very rapidly. And so cholera is due to the failure to for this intestinal reabsorption of water to occur. And so people eventually realized that you could give IV electrolytes, if you could get the person to in some form of medical care, you could put an IV line in them and keep them hydrated. Eventually they realized that they could do it with oral electrolytes, so long as they were given with glucose. And so without the glucose to provide energy, the transport couldn't occur. And I think this is where Gatorade was eventually developed for. Other things that affect the drug, there are some pharmaceutical things, which is the form in which the drug is given. So most of the time, there are some liquid formulations that you take. So something like ribotussin will be a liquid formulation. But on the other hand, many of them are in the form of a pill. And so the pill is a piece of solid. And so in some cases, what people do is they will compound the solid along with some sodium bicarbonate. And when this hits the small intestine, the stomach, where it's acidic, the acid will react with the sodium bicarbonate to make carbon dioxide and sodium chloride, and it will cause an explosion of the tablet. So the tablet is actually broken up under the force of this reaction, because you're producing carbon dioxide gas. This can be a way to much improve the recovery. So sometimes, depending on the pharmaceutical formulation, you may get different total absorption rates of the drugs. You get the same amount of drug taken by mouth, but the actual form of the drug can be altered by the formulation that it's put into. Talked about capsules, so they prevent premature absorption and also smooth transit down through the esophageal passage, and will prevent acidic obstruction in the stomach, as I said, maybe gelatin. And this is particularly useful for people who have pancreatic insufficiencies or cystic fibrosis, to actually put some enzymes that you need to replace inside the capsule. And so these are delivered down into the small intestine, but they would gradually degrade and release the enzymes contained in the capsule, and help prevent some of the symptoms of these diseases. There are physical chemical things which we sometimes see when you're reading the thing, don't take this on an empty stomach, or sometimes take it on an empty stomach. Because it depends on what the pH of the stomach is. So an empty stomach, the pH is going to be very low. So things that will get protonated won't get absorbed very well under very acidic conditions. An amino group that's protonated. If a carboxylic acid was protonated, then it wouldn't have any charge. And therefore that compound would have an increase in uptake. So you have to look at the drug. It depends. Some drugs they take on an empty stomach before a meal, depending on what you use. And others will say take during a meal. And all of this is governed by something called the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. I'll show you this here. So at a particular pH, there is a prevailing thing called the pKa. And it's the pKa plus the log of the concentration of the negatively charged form of the drug divided by the amount of the protonated drug, which has no charge in it. If these two are the same, if this then a similar formula for the drug that picks up a proton is positively charged. So when these two are the same, it's the log of one. The log of one is zero. And so the pKa is a term we might look at, which is the pH at which the drug is half ionized. So if we know that, then we can start to say, okay, well now we can't take this one on empty stomach, because we know it's pKa, when it starts to get more than 50% of it is become charged, that's going to slow down the rate of absorption too much. So in that case, we won't take it on after a meal. So pKa is the pH when the drug is half ionized. And so if we go back to here, so here you've got, this is the blood side in the nephron, and this is the urine side. So you notice that the urine is more acidic than the blood is. So if you have a compound here that's got an amine group on it, it will be in equilibrium with its charge state. So the charge state can't go through the cells because it's got a bunch of charge on it. But the non-charged state can. So it will go through, and when it gets into the urine side, it will become heavily charged, and so therefore it cannot be reabsorbed. Whereas the non-charged species can go back to here. So that's why the drug, when it's going through the blood, some of it will spill out and go into the urine. And it depends on the chemistry of the compound, how much is excreted in this particular case. So then there are compounds, obviously, that you might also be taking at the same time as a particular drug that can alter the pH. So for instance, if you had an upset stomach, you might have be all the way to having an ulcer. Or there are people who have gastrin-producing tumors that create just constant acidity. Or if you've got H. pylori, which is an organism that grows, which gives rise to inflammation in the stomach. So in that case, you want to try to get rid of that acidity. So you're going to take compounds that will neutralize the acid. Or you can have compounds that alter the secretion of the acid. And under those circumstances, you may now alter the conditions for the uptake of the drug that you've taken orally, which you've now artificially changed the pH. So you have to think about that before. So we'll talk about GI drugs more later, and I'll expand that. There are other things that affect how a drug is presented for absorption, and that can be the issue of phase separation. So if you don't generate enough lipase, let's say you have cystic fibrosis, so you have a lot of undigested lipid in the small intestine, then sometimes the drug will prefer to go into that oily phase and therefore not be available in the water phase to make its way towards the wall of the intestine and hence be absorbed. So it's important for cystic fibrosis, people who have pancreatic insufficiency, and sometimes people with liver failure who don't make enough bile acids. And then people who are given paraffins to help them pass stools when they've had surgery, so they don't want to put strain too much. They give them a lubricant in the form of paraffins, and that can slow the uptake of things like fluoroquinolones. Another thing that's going on in the small intestine is that You're not only secreting enzymes that digest lipids, but you're also secreting bile acids from the liver. And the bile acids are acting like a soap, a detergent. And so they form micelles, and these micelles can capture things that are very water insoluble and put them into a phase that looks like a soluble water phase. And so you have an encapsulation of the materials that cholesterol, free fatty acids, that are not water soluble, but they're in this micelle that's got bile acids on the outside and phospholipids arranged here. And so it's very important that you have enough bile acids. So I studied a boy in London who had cystic fibrosis chronically, and he got to the point of having rickets. So the malabsorption was so extensive, it was vitamin D. He couldn't, although he had vitamin D in his diet, the vitamin D was not getting into the body to make the bone that he needed. And so we had to get administered by a tube. We put a tube down into the small intestine and administer bile acids directly. If you put bile acids in the mouth, it will be very heavy. It tastes terrible and it will do bad things to your esophagus. But so we had to bite, we had to chew, you know, through his mouth, down into his small intestine, and then administer the bile acid there, and it's effective. Okay. So once the compound has got into the body, where does it go to next? So we want it to be distributed. Most of the distribution is going to be through the bloodstream. There is a route where the chylomicrons go through, which is a little different. But most of them are going to go through the blood. And so they will, in about 2 to 3 minutes after absorption, they would have been pretty much distributed uniformly around the body, assuming nothing else happens. Within the vascular space, of course, you've got another set of cells. So you've got an endothelial lining layer within the blood vessel. And now drugs can perhaps get through that as well. So most of the things you want to have being the target are going to be inside another cell. So the same features that you use to get the drug through the gastrointestinal wall are going to apply to the endothelial cell wall, and compounds now can be transferred from the bloodstream into the blood. This can be very expensive. You know, you can sometimes have, compared to what's in the blood, many, many, many times the concentration within the tissues. It depends on the transport processes or capturing process that's going on within the cells, is that how much that occurs. Okay. And then a particular area that's a real challenge in pharmacology are drugs that need to get to the brain. So for the most part, we don't want foreign compounds getting into the brain. Now, so of course, some of the recreational drugs are designed because they do get into the brain, and they're often taken in such a way that the distribution to the brain is maximized. So if you were to inhale the smoke compound and compare its activity from taking it orally or even intramuscularly, you'll get a much bigger effect from smoking. Anybody want to tell me why? Physiology? So where does the blood go in the lung? Some of it goes directly to the brain before it comes down to the liver or to the heart. So there is a trend, but when you absorb things by inhalation, there is if the compound can be absorbed into the brain, then that's another issue. But it will happen the fastest, and that's why that's the method that you see people using. So the blood-brain barrier is much tighter. The tight junctions are even tighter than they are in the small intestine. So the idea is that you don't have things getting into the brain if you can pump it, which is a challenge because sometimes you do want the pharmaceutical to get to the brain. the blood-brain barrier. It has very tight junctions. There is also another barrier in the choroid plexus that's going to separate the blood from the cerebral spinal fluid, which is used to regulate the brain. Despite that, there are transporters for things that the brain really needs, so amino acids and glucose can enter the brain easily. And the brain is actually incredibly active from a metabolic point of view, so it consumes a large amount of calories in the brain. And humans have big brains compared to the related species that we have. So it's very important that we can get those physiological compounds into the brain. Much tougher to get a drug into the brain. Unfortunately, for the most part, microorganisms can't get in, although microorganism products sometimes can pass into the brain. So again, we'll mention this in the GI drugs. Codeine is isotope graft using codeine as a formulation called kaolin, which is, you have kaolin, kaopectate, to stop diarrhea. It's disgusting, tastes terrible. But in England, it used to have a little bit of codeine added to it. And the codeine causes the circular muscles in the intestine to tighten up, and that's how it stops the diarrhea. But of course, the codeine, as we'll see in a minute, is a compound that's now carefully regulated, so you guys can't get the codeine that I used to be able to get. Not that I knew anything about it, and it's just what the diarrhea. And so this is codeine. It's quite a complicated compound. It's a natural compound, so it's a compound that is hard to make. It's a derivative of morphine. So the only difference between it and morphine is this methyl group up here. So codeine is a drug that was a derivative of morphine. Another drug that we use, if you go into the pharmacy and just look around the GI drugs, don't get the pharmacist to upset because sometimes when you go around and think very nervous, you have to come and find out what you're looking at. Not quite sure what you're up to. I usually have to explain to the pharmacologists and trying to get some ideas and teach them, which is true, and sometimes they do. But there are drugs that have been developed for diarrhea that do not cross the blood-brain barrier. So this is one of them. And so the pharmacologists have developed this as an anti-diarrheal agent, which is much safer. Eliminating drugs, so we obviously the drug is optimized to be able to get into the body. And because of that, it's going to stay there unless something happens to it. And the things that can happen to it are to undergo metabolism. Usually, it's done by phase one, but we'll probably have talks on this later, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. But it's driven by what we call the cytokine E450 system. It was thought to be one common or one mechanism when I first got here at UAB. Now we realize it's about 50 or more different enzymes, each with its own peculiar activity against individual drugs. An example of a drug that didn't come out easily is DTT, or DDT, which was used as an anti-malaria. But unfortunately, when people died and they examined them, they found that DDT was actually still there 30, 40 years after the people were exposed to it. So there's a risk that a drug can get into the system and then just stay there and perhaps have negative effects in the long term. So heroin, you've heard about heroin. Heroin is another form of morphine. So heroin is the diacetyl derivative of morphine. Because it's diacetyl, it's going to be much more easily absorbed, and it's bioactive, and so the metabolism in the body turns it into morphine, and this is the bioactive compound. And as we noted just now, codeine is also a form of morphine. So if you get morphine on its own, it's by mouth, it's very hard to get an effect. It's just like the extra part I mentioned in the debate. So if you have to have morphine, it's usually given intravenously. I was on a, actually a person who used to be in pharmacology, used to be the chair of pharmacology, not the chair, he was the chair of the science part of pharmacology. He and I were on a deck at a party down in Altenburg, about two floors up, and the deck had only got really one support that was holding the deck up. The other was just some nails and binoculars and wood. And about 20 people went out on the deck. It was a party to celebrate somebody who was leaving. And the deck fell. And fortunately, my wife landed on top of me, so she hit something soft. The person I was standing next to had his foot, had his leg broken, and his foot pulled out of the ankle socket.
And, I was on that deck.
Yeah, you were there too.
I was there too. Yeah.
So I broke something in my foot, I was standing right next to him. I couldn't be the guy who was seriously hurt. We both went to hospital, and they treated him, obviously, with things to kill the pain. But the problem, the side effect of this is that it will lower the respiration rate. And his respiration rate had gotten really low, so they had to give him an antibiotic. And as a result, his pain came back. So I was on one gurney, and he was on the other gurney. I could study the pharmacology in this sort of rather extreme London, because he wouldn't have thought I was very sympathetic thinking. Okay, so, and then there's a second form of metabolism where you actually put different attachments to the drug, glucuronides, sulfate groups, amino acids. And these things help to get rid of the drug more rapidly. And so generally they're more excretable. And you'll learn more about this in the following lectures. So some compounds are extracted from the blood by the liver, and then they're put back into the bile, and they will go down the gastrointestinal tract, and will appear in the feces. Some of them can be metabolized by the intestinal bacteria and get reabsorbed. We worked on a drug metabolite of an anti-cancer drug, 5-fluorouracil, and actually found it was made from bile acid conjugates, which kept it in, kept at least part of the molecule in the body for long periods of time. And then the kidney filters blood through the glomerulus, so the material, the fluid, it goes down the proximal tubule. And that has transporters much like you see in the small intestine. And so some drugs can be actually recovered that way. Or it's also a discrete excretion process. So now I want to get into the issue of potency. You know, why we use this term, a potent drug, and also combine that with efficacy. The two are not the same. Okay, so the potency is essentially how much of the drug do you need to actually get a particular effect. Whereas the efficacy is the maximum effect you would get if you gave the maximum amount of drug. And the two are not equivalent. So a drug might have a very an effect, a measurable effect, at very low concentration, but it may not never get the maximum effect. But you can have a more efficacious drug. And so this is an example of a compound. So this is the log drug concentration here. So lower and lower concentrations as we go in this direction. This drug is much more potent because it has its effect at much lower concentrations. This drug is more efficacious because it causes a bigger total effect, but it does so at a much higher concentration. Okay? So that's the difference between potency and efficacy. Okay, fun. I thought this is not on this what I'm focused on this morning. I was hearing a discussion about fentanyl and the number of people who are dying from fentanyl overdose. And I thought it was a very interesting one to use with regard to this efficacy issue or the potency issue. So fentanyl is a painkiller. It's used widely in medicine. And of course, it's also being apparently used recreationally as well. So it's a synthetic compound, and its analog is morphine. And so fentanyl is actually 50 times more potent than morphine. I think morphine is an active drug, but actually fentanyl is even better. And it's because we've used our knowledge of the chemistry to improve how long the drug sits on the receptor that it's attacking. And so, thousands of people die. As you know, the drug problem with painkillers is really catastrophic. It's far worse than all our worst enemies put together. We're actually the biggest terrorist in this country is ourselves and our use of drugs that we can get available to us. Now, I hope I can mention two of